In the same month in which their Majesties Ferdinand and Isabella gave me the order to undertake my expedition of discovery to the Indies, in the same month, they issued the edict that all Jews should be driven out of the kingdom and its territories.
Thus began the diary of Christopher Columbus. As he set sail on his epic voyage of discovery, he observed numerous ships carrying Jews that were leaving Spain. 1492 marked the beginning of a new era in the West. But for the Jews of Spain, it was the end of what had once been a glorious period. For nearly 800 years, the Muslims had occupied Spain. In the 10th century, Jews and Moors working together would forge a civilization centered in the city of Córdoba that would be unequal in its time for its learning and for its architectural magnificence. The Muslims call Spain Al-Andalus. The Jews of Spain call it Sephard. Thus, the Jews of Spain were called Sephardim or Sephardim. As Arabic civilization flourished, so did that of the Sephardim. Talmudic academies were established. Translations of Greek classics were undertaken, as were investigations into science, mathematics, and astronomy. It was an era of intellect and of aesthetics, an era that witnessed the flowering of Hebrew poetry into forms and styles rivaled in literary brilliance only by the prophets of biblical times. Poet-philosophers such as Yehuda Halevi and Solomon Ibn Gabirol were among those who created an era that would come to be called the Golden Age of Hebrew literature. The best Jewish and Muslim minds were occupied by a renewed interest in Greek philosophy and by their attempts to reconcile it with their religious beliefs. In Córdoba arose the greatest Jewish thinker of his time, Moses ben Maimon, or Maimonides as he is called, who single-handedly codified all of biblical and rabbinical law in a series of monumental works. His influence upon future generations was such that it would be said, from Moses to Moses, there arose none such as Moses. The Golden Age came to a close in the mid-12th century when fanatical North African Muslims called Almohades raged through Andalusia, forcing Islam upon all in their path. The famed school of Jewish translators in Córdoba was forced to flee to Toledo, which had fallen into Christian hands. Toledo had been declared the capital of Christian Spain, and the city soon became the new cultural center of Jewish life. Its synagogues were designed in the popular Mudéjar style and were constructed by the finest artisans and craftsmen of their day. The Muslims, despite all their accomplishments, were unable to prevent the Christians from reconquering the Iberian Peninsula. By the early 13th century, the Christians had reconquered all of Spain, except for the Moorish kingdom of Granada. The Spanish Jews integrated themselves as best they could into the fabric of the newly dominant Spanish society. Spanish became in time the language of the day, and the Jews became imbued with the spirit, the customs, and the songs of their Christian neighbors. But the religious differences between Jew and Christian seemed unbridgeable. Fanatics aroused the Christian populace to riot against the Jewish unbelievers in their midst. In the year 1391, beginning in the Juderia or Jewish quarter of Sevilla and spreading from there to many of the cities of Spain, a series of massacres occurred, resulting in the death of thousands of Jews and in the forced conversion of over 100,000 Jews to Christianity. Many of these forcibly converted Jews continued to practice their Jewish religion in secret. These secret Jews were called Marranos. In the year 1480, the Inquisition was established in order to find and punish these Marranos, outwardly Christian, inwardly Jews, who, after they had been denounced and turned over to the Inquisition, were interrogated and tortured in order to obtain a confession. After sentence had been passed on their souls, the Inquisition arranged for a mass spectacle called an auto da fe, at which the transgressors were publicly humiliated, strangled, or burned at the stake. By 1492, as the last Muslim stronghold at Granada surrendered to the combined forces of Ferdinand and Isabella, the Edict of Expulsion was declared, ordering the Jews to either accept Christianity or to leave Spain. The reason? The Jews encouraged the Marranos to be disloyal to Christianity. About 150,000 Jews were thus forced to evacuate Spain. The Sephardim, broken-hearted, their wealth confiscated, their communities in shambles. Their sea vessels of escape attacked and plundered by pirates were dispersed throughout the Mediterranean. The great majority of the exiles settled in the Ottoman Turkish Empire, which welcomed the Sephardim in their search for a place of refuge. It was for the Spanish Jews a time to rebuild, a time to heal the wounds of persecution and of expulsion. Istanbul, previously known as Constantinople, came to have the largest Sephardic community in the Ottoman Empire. In this bustling city on the shores of the Bosphorus and next to the Sea of Marmara, the Spanish exiles made use of the commercial and industrial skills that they had acquired in Spain. Some were craftsmen, others physicians. A few were statesmen who distinguished themselves in the court of the Sultan. Many were merchants in the great Turkish bazaar where they marketed their goods. The great majority, however, were common people. The Jews of Istanbul were organized as a self-governing religious and administrative community called a millet, as was the practice of minorities everywhere under the Turkish system of rule. Their religious life was guided initially by some of the greatest Jewish scholars from Spain, and later by successive generations of talented leaders, among them the community's chief rabbi called the Chacham Bashi. In their public and private lives, they continued to make use of the Spanish that they had brought with them from Spain. Over the centuries, thousands of books in Judeo-Spanish, written with the use of Hebrew letters, would be printed on a wide variety of subjects. The greatest literary work of this community was written in Judeo-Spanish. It was called the Meam Loez, a monumental 15-volume interpretive work of biblical and rabbinical literature. It was begun in the 18th century and required several decades and authors to complete. In the 19th century, Istanbul had an active Ladino or Judeo-Spanish press. However, in the early 20th century, Jews were forced to write Ladino with the use of the Roman alphabet instead of with Hebrew letters. This happened during a period of extensive social upheaval in Turkey, a period of intense nationalism that witnessed the loss of the community's independence, forcing many Sephardim to emigrate to Europe, to North, and especially to South America. After World War II, the majority of the Turkish community immigrated to the newly formed State of Israel. However, the pride of the Sephardim, the Sephardic mother city par excellence, was a town in northern Greece called Thessaloniki, or Salonica. 20,000 Sephardim had settled there immediately after the expulsion, and the community had grown to 70,000 by this century. Many of its 30 Sephardic congregations were named after the region in Spain from which the exiles had come: Aragon, Castile, Catalonia, Provençal. It was renowned as the greatest Sephardic center of Jewish learning and scholarship. Throughout the streets of Salonica, one could hear the Judeo-Spanish of old being spoken. At weddings and other festive occasions, the traditional ballads or romances would be sung. Even its common workers added to its renown and fame. Indeed, because many of the stevedores in the port of Salonica were Sephardim, it was until recently the only seaport in the Mediterranean that closed down on the Sabbath. Salonica was truly a Sephardic jewel to behold. It is no more. The entire community was destroyed by the Nazis in World War II. Another Sephardic community that met its fate at the hands of the Nazis was that of Holland. Here to Amsterdam in the 16th and 17th centuries had come many Spanish, Portuguese, Jewish families, among the many Muranos who had been able to escape from the long arm of the Inquisition. In Holland, the Sephardim were able to practice their religion openly, a freedom that they had been denied in Spain and in Portugal. The prayer halls and the homes of the Spanish Portuguese Jews radiated an intensity and a glow of religious life that had been born of their struggle against the Inquisition. It was an elite community with a literary and cultural life equal to anything produced in Madrid and Lisbon. Amsterdam became the publishing center for Hebrew and Spanish books, an activity that, along with its cultural life, earned it the name of the Dutch Jerusalem. Paradoxically, one of the products of this community was the brilliant Baruch Spinoza, regarded as the father of modern philosophy. Spinoza's heretical religious beliefs and philosophical views resulted in his excommunication. Among the members of the Amsterdam community were merchants active in the Dutch West India Company, merchants who were responsible for allowing the first Jews to settle in the Dutch colony of New Amsterdam, later to be called New York. Sephardim were thus the first Jews to arrive in America. The Sephardic communities of Amsterdam, of Salonica, and of others such as Monastir and the island of Rhodes had been totally destroyed. What was left of the Sephardic world after the Nazi Holocaust was weakened even further by the mass uprooting and migration of Sephardic communities that took place afterwards. The Judeo-Spanish world of the Sephardim is withering away. It was a world rudely transplanted from the soil of Spain onto foreign terrains, where regardless of the surrounding circumstances, it had taken root and prospered and maintained its distinctive Hispanic identity until modern times. This is the story of two of the last strongholds of the Sephardic tradition and of the song of Spain that they have preserved to this day. This is the song of the Sephardi. Your God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might, and these words which I command thee this day shall be upon thy heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and thou shalt speak of them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up, and thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thy hand, and they shall be for frontlets between thine eyes, and thou shalt write them on the doorposts of thy house and upon thy gates.
In modern parlance, this is called, you don't judge a book by its cover. You don't judge a person by his outward appearance. You must look inside. And this is very graphically illustrated by a beautiful Sephardic story.
This is Rabbi Solomon Maimon. He is an Orthodox rabbi, but he is also a Sephardi, a descendant of the Jews that were expelled from Spain in 1492.
And his wife kept nagging him, we must find a husband for our daughter.
He is the rabbi for one of the two traditional Sephardic communities in Seattle. His community is composed of Sephardim mainly from Turkey, whereas the other is made up of Sephardim from the island of Rhodes. Like most of the members of his congregation, Rabbi Maimon was born in Turkey, and he immigrated to Seattle in the United States during the early 20th century.
Es bien sabido que en su cos una de las misiones importantes es que cada yucal que tome.
He speaks Ladino or Judeo-Spanish, the medieval Castilian dialect that the Sephardim have maintained for nearly 500 years since the expulsion from Spain. Ladino is basically medieval Spanish, but which also has a certain number of Turkish, Greek, and Hebrew words. He often makes use of the Miamloez with its repository of Sephardic folklore in his sermons and teaching sessions. And as a speaker of Ladino, Rabbi Maimon has been primarily responsible for preserving the Sephardic tradition in Seattle.
We in the city of Seattle have been in existence for the last 70 years as a Sephardic community. Well, we believe we are a very viable Sephardic community, in fact, one of the very best in America. And we've been very tenacious in keeping the ancient Sephardic traditions in our homes and in our synagogues and in our community. We have a community of 3,000 souls, two synagogues with 300 members each, and both synagogues keep the traditions very well. In America, the situation is not the same. Unfortunately, the interest in Sephardic traditions is waning because there is the lack of knowledge and the lack of appreciation of the beauty of the Sephardic traditions. What we have done is, for example, in the Passover, the seder is conducted both in the Hebrew and in Ladino. On Kippur, we still say certain things in Ladino. We cite the Copas de Purim. There is a special book of Copas de Purim, and on Purim celebrations, we cite those. On Shavuot, we tenaciously hold on to the Ketubah de Lale, which is composed in Ladino, which is a very beautiful poem about the marriage of the Jewish people to God, and the Ketubah, which is the marriage contract. And that is sung and chanted in the Ladino. Shabbat, the Aftara, is still chanted in the old Ladino. Even though many people may not understand it, we've published it, and we practice it in the synagogue today. So if you come to our community, if you come to our synagogue, you will see Ladino, and you will see Sephardic rituals in their riches and actually being practiced.
Baruch ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech Haolam Asher Kidishanu B'mitzvotav Tzivanu Lachniso B'vritot Shel Avraham Avinu.
Amen.
Baruch ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech Haolam Shehechiyanu V'kiyimanu V'higyanu Lazman Hazeh.
Amen. Kishen Shehech Natsol Atem Barir Ken Yikanez La Torah La Mitzvot La Chopa Ulevasim Tumim V'chen Yiratzon V'nomar Amen.
I remember that the most difficult berit milah, most difficult ritual circumcision that I ever performed was on our firstborn son, Abraham. The night before, I didn't sleep. When the day came, my hands were trembling. I could hardly see straight. Perspiration was running all over me. I approached it with the most trepidation in my life. I've never felt that way before. With my hands shaking, I performed. And after the performance, I examined Abraham, and thank God everything turned out all right. After that, when it was over, I really, all I wanted to do was to imbibe and take a few beautiful rakis in order to forget all the excitement, in order to forget all the nervousness that I went through.
Por el raquí me muero, de beberlo no me ardí de tanto amarlo. Me siento yo y yo varón, me siento yo primario. Al cajón me siento millonario. La vida do por el raquí, no puedo yo dejarlo. De beberlo no me ardí de tanto amarlo. De beberlo no me ardí de tanto amarlo.
Muadim le simcha, muadim le simcha.
Muadim
le simcha. Muadim le simcha.
Muadim le simcha.
Perhaps the most beautiful of all the Jewish festivals is Passover, or Pesach, which celebrates the miraculous liberation and deliverance of the ancient Israelites from the hand of Pharaoh in Egypt, and which is observed by the eating of unleavened bread called matzah. No foods that are leavened are allowed to be eaten. The festival lasts a week and begins with a Seder service held at home.
Kadesh, saliendo de Arvid, si es que salieron las estrellas, hincharán los vasos de vino y dirán kiddush.
Sabri maranah
lechaim.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam bore peri
cada uno su vaso ha rescordado.
Urchatz, se lavarán las manos y no dirán berajá. ¿Por qué? Porque no vamos a comer matzá.
Carpaz. Tomarán la ojica de apio y entiñerán en el vinagre o en agua de sal y dirán, Baruch ata amona elokenu melech haolam, bore peri adama.
Yachatz, tomarán las tres matzot shemurot. La de en medio partirán media por media. La media meterán entre las dos. Y la otra media meterán debajo de los manteles para ficomín. Hincharán los vasos de vino y dirán la agada.
Este el pan de la aflicción que comieron nuestros padres en tierra de Egipto. Todo el que tiene hambre venga y coma. Todo el que tiene de menester venga y pascue. Este año aquí, a el año el viñen en tierra de Israel. Este año aquí, siervos, a el año el viñen en tierra de Israel y os foros.
Maror, tomarán de la lechuga y entiñerán en el jaroset y dirán, Baruch atam una elokenu melech haolam. Alachilat maror.
Amen.
Shulchan orech, y aparejarán la mesa y cenarán.
Quien supiense y entendiense, alabar al Dios creense, cuáles son los treyes son los Icarim, dos hermanos con Yosef, once hermanos sin Yosef, diez mandamientos son, nueve meses de la preñada, ocho días de la mila, siete días con Shabbat, seis libros de la Mishnah, cinco libros de la ley, cuatro madres de Israel, tres nuestros padres son, dos Moshe y Aarón, uno es el Criador, Baruch, Baruch Shemo.
Unlike their Ashkenazic brethren, Sephardim consider it a privilege for grandchildren to be named after grandparents who are alive and well. And after each of the grandparents' names has been used, deceased members of the family are then remembered by naming a child after them. It is the Sephardic surname that hints at their illustrious history, names that go back hundreds of years to medieval times. Some of the names indicate the city or province in Spain from which their ancestors originated. Others are simple common Spanish names that were taken over by Sephardim. Some are of Arabic origin, and others are Hebrew names. And from the moment a Sephardic child is born, major events of one's life, from childhood until one's old age, are filled with Ladino song.
Thank you. yo te haré prender. Si tú no tienes amante, yo te haré prender. Alma y vida y corazón, alma y vida y corazón. A la una yo nací, a las dos me engrandecí. A la una yo nací, a las dos me engrandecí. A las tres tomé amante, a las cuatro me casé. A las tres tomé amante, a las cuatro me casé. Alma y vida y corazón, alma y vida y corazón.
Fortuna Calvo was the first Sephardic child to be born and reared in Seattle.
My father, Solomon Calvo, with Jack Policar, were the first Sephardic Jews that arrived in Seattle. And as they were got off the train and they were walking on the street, they met a Greek man. And they asked him if he could show them where they could go to meet some Jewish people. And this Greek man thought about it for a while, and then he says, I can take you to a Jewish tailor. And they said, fine. So he took him to this Jewish tailor, and he talked to the two boys, but they did not speak Yiddish, and they were speaking Spanish. So he told them to stay. And in the evening, he took them home. And he took them home to his wife, and his wife says, who are these young boys? She asked her husband. He said, these two boys were brought to this door and they're telling us that they're Jewish and they have no place to go. And she said, good, leave them here, have them come in. And they tried to talk to them, but they couldn't talk to each other. They couldn't speak Yiddish. And they tried speaking in Spanish. They couldn't be they weren't understood. So they said, fine, you stay. But they were wondering if they were Jewish. And finally, my father said to them, in motions, bring me a book. I will read to you. So they brought him a Hebrew book, and he read to them from the Hebrew book. But he didn't read like they do. It wasn't the same. And they sent a letter to New York asking, we have two boys here that are telling us they're Jewish. They do not speak Yiddish, and they do not read the Hebrew like we do. They speak Spanish. Are these boys Jewish? And my father used to tell us, with tears in his eyes, that when the letter came back, it said, these boys are Jewish, just like you. They are Sephardim.
The preservation of Judaism rests primarily on education. If the Sephardic culture and its beautiful traditions are to perpetuate themselves, it has to be through a process of education. It must begin.
Community leaders have attempted to get youthful Sephardim interested in preserving the Ladino tradition. But at this time in their lives, certain young men and women have something else on their minds.
Love me.
The crowning day of the week in Sephardic Jewish life is the Sabbath, the Shabbat, the festive day of rest and prayer, which begins at Friday sunset.
Paz y amor al mundo entero. Dios que manda refuerzo y amor a todos que están sufriendo. Escapamiento bueno a todas las preñadas y mi muera también. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
The Sabbath candles are lit, appropriate blessings over wine, and the Sabbath bread called challah are made.
Lechem minare. Amen.
The Sephardic cuisine is very different from what most people commonly think of as being so-called Jewish. There is no gefilte fish or matzah balls or borscht. There are many other traditional dishes, such as burrecas, bizcochos, panecicos, yeprakas, and the eggs cooked all night in the oven till they are dark brown, and therefore called huevos jaminados.
Vivas! Frescas! Para bueno! Te engrandezcas, hijo bueno!
Ya comimos y vivimos y adiós, santo.
With the completion of the meal, the Hebrew grace after meals is said and is often followed by this traditional song.
Padre grande que mande al chico, así contenemos de menester para nuestras casas y para nuestros hijos. El Dios nos oiga y nos responda y nos apiade por su nombre el grande que somos, almicas sin pecados. Odula monaikito, kile olam hasdo. Odula monaikito, kile olam hasdo. Siempre mejor, nunca peor. Nunca más mal que la mesa del Creador. Amén.
The following day, the community gets together for Sabbath morning services and for the traditional reading of a portion of the Torah, consisting of the five books of Moses. The members bid for the honor of doing the mitzvot, or ceremonial duties done as preparations for the reading of the Torah. The individual contribution is then used for synagogue and other charitable purposes.
Mil dan por meter los rimonim, mil dan. Dos mil dan por ivar y traer sefer Torah. Dos mil dan. Mil y quinientos dan por hacer la gilila. Mil dan por hacer la cama, mil y quinientos dan. Mil y quinientos dan por hacer la cama. Quinientos dan por mildar la aftara.
In the Sephardic tradition, when an individual is called up for a reading of the Torah, the younger members of the family stand in his honor.
Yevarechecha
The cantor reads the portion with meticulous fidelity to tradition and does so without any improvisation.
Cinco dólares de Shemen la Mahora, la memoria de su suegra Esther Benvenisten, y cinco dólares de Shemen la Mahora por la salud buena de su cosuegro Israel Halfón, y cinco dólares a la honor de los nuevos casados de su sobrino Benjamín y Janet Babani.
After the Torah reading, the individual is blessed by the cantor and by the congregation. But after nearly 75 years of existence, even this Sephardic community, considered by many to be the most traditional, is showing signs of cultural disintegration. Ladino culture is slowly fading away in Seattle. The American melting pot and geographical dispersion have taken their toll. Few of the grandchildren of the original founding fathers are able to understand or to speak Ladino. Yet despite the decline of Ladino as a spoken language in Seattle, events on occasion occur that seem to breathe new life into this community.
Very much. Good evening to all of you, ladies and gentlemen. Buenas noches. Buenas tardes, señores y señoras. The next song tells about three daughters of a father. The two of them were married, got themselves husbands, grew a beautiful family, but one of them stepped out of line, and he was prepared to punish her most severely by sending her out of the country, out of his home, out of his surroundings, just because she has endangered the name and the good morals of his family. The name of the song is Tres Hermanicas Eran.
Tres hermanicas son, tres hermanicas.
Coming to Israel is truly a homecoming. It is home for 3 million Jews who have come there from all over the world. And it is home for nearly 500,000 Sephardic Jews who speak Ladino or Judeo-Spanish. Israel now has the largest Ladino-speaking population in the world. My parents came to Israel from Turkey. We spoke Ladino at home, along with Hebrew. My parents both loved to sing and to listen to Spanish romances, and I learned many of the songs that I know from them. Being Sephardic has always meant something special to me. I like to think that in the few Ladino concerts that I've given, I've helped to keep alive just a little longer what I inherited from my parents. The Sephardic population in the land of Israel has been present since the expulsion from Spain. It was not until the late 19th and 20th centuries that the population of Sephardim increased greatly. For centuries, many had come because they wanted to live in Eretz Israel, the land of Israel, their ancient Jewish homeland. The persecuted Jews of Europe, or what was left of them, Sephardim and Ashkenazim alike, sought refuge in the newborn state of Israel in the hope of national rebirth. And the center of a Jewish national home would, of course, have to be Jerusalem, the city of David, the home of their ancient temple, and the site of Mount Zion, from which, according to biblical prophecy, shall go forth the law. Jerusalem has a special place in the heart and mind of every Jew. It is my favorite city. Its antiquity, its spiritual atmosphere, and the vitality of its people all make it one of the most fascinating cities in the world. Many Sephardim live here in such areas as Machane Yehuda and Ohel Moshe. And Sephardim live here because it is their quarter of town, their home within a home. And one never knows what will show up next in this area.
יש לי עוד אלישי, ירד. ירד. יודי, אבא שכונת מחיר ירד.
Dulces, almendras, frutas secas, dátiles, pipitas, bilibises para Shabbat. Pipitas,
in Israel, people coming from 102 different countries, speaking 81 languages. I suppose that in Israel we'll find almost 500,000 people who understand Ladino. Yugoslavia, Turkey, Greece, Rhodes, some from Romania. And like all other languages, Jewish languages, like Yiddish and others, which were creations of the Jewish people, here in Israel, under the pressure of life and the melting pot that exists here, they tend to disappear, to evaporate, to be forgotten. A lot has been done in order to preserve the language, if not the language, at least its spiritual heritage, the music, the songs. I had the privilege of being involved personally with two shows, musical shows, one Romancero, the other one the Bustan Sephardi, which means the Sephardi orchard, where we try to depict the life of a Sephardi family in Jerusalem 50, 60 years ago, together with songs, music, dancing. And judging by the response of the people, you could have seen how much enthusiasm, how much involved people are, and how much love there is between the people and their spiritual heritage. A certain person to whom we owe much is the late Mr. Yitzhak Levy, who passed away lately. He composed 9 books, anthology of the Sephardi liturgy of the synagogue, very rich collection of the rituals of the Sephardi communities in all parts of the diaspora. You have from Greece, from Salonica, from Amsterdam, North Africa, London, other places, one prayer, for example, Yigdal Elohim Chai, you have more than 120 different melodies. There is a daily audition on the radio, transmission on the radio, news and music every day. There are a few newspapers. Lately, the Ministry for Education and Culture has introduced the Ladino as an optional language in school together with Yiddish. So if you cannot teach the language to all the people, and maybe you cannot fight the stream of history, but at least there is a real effort to preserve as much as possible of that rich and so exciting heritage that we inherited from our ancestors.
In past generations, the Sephardic woman was mainly a woman of the house, and her two tasks in life were to rear the children and to take care of the household. This was all that was demanded of her, and often all that was permitted to her. And because she was not obligated to attend religious services as the men were, her religious and secular education was limited. Some, however, did attend special girls' schools. And yet it was, as it still is today, the Sephardic mother who was mainly responsible for preserving the Spanish language. Up until the late 19th century, in Jerusalem, in Turkey and other Balkan countries, this medieval Spanish was the only language that these mothers knew. Ladino was their mother tongue. And it was the Sephardic mother who would sing to her children the songs and the ballads that had been passed on through the generations. The traditional Sephardic woman was regarded as virtuous if, in addition to her household and childcare duties, she had learned a minor manual skill that could be of practical use to the family. Many learned how to embroider or to sew, to make one's own clothing. To have mastered such a skill was the final touch to one's perfection as a woman. But there were always a few who, try as they may, never quite got the hang of it.
Me rogó que se la meta, como se va a hacer.
cómo se va a hacer amar, cómo se va a hacer la 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 la.
The traditional Sephardic family has always been close-knit, orthodox in its religious practice, and dignified in its manner. The younger members of the family are respectful of one's elders, especially one's grandfather called Papu, and one's grandmother called Noni. Hospitality plays an important part in their lives, and they always receive guests with special consideration. Traditionally, a guest is offered a drink of cold water and sweet jelly to start off the visit.
Está muy hermoso, el fluido en casa.
Es una labor buena. Es una labor muy buena.
Fluido en casa. El Dios que te dé las vidas buenas.
Amén. Ridículo.
En las vidas de tu marido y de tus hijos.
Ay, mamá.
Ay.
The Sephardic musical repertoire has been estimated to consist of at least 300 folk songs and ballads. Scholars from Spain have shown great interest in Ladino folk songs. After the expulsion in 1492, the Sephardim had no further contact with the Iberian Peninsula. Over the centuries, the Spaniards had forgotten the songs, but the Sephardim in their isolation had preserved them through the use of Ladino as a spoken language. In their songs, the Sephardim sing of life and of death, of love and romance, of courtship and of beauty. And in the eyes of the Sephardi, the fairest of the maidens was not fair of skin at all, but was traditionally a Morenica, a graceful maiden, dark and comely of appearance, with flowing hair and the eyes deep brown. This was the ideal of beauty.
Graciosa.
Whether the song of the Sephardi will continue to be heard generations from now will ultimately depend on today's Sephardic youth and their commitment to Ladino. With rare exceptions, such a commitment has not been forthcoming. And the likelihood is that within two or three generations, the song of the Sephardi will be a song whose day has passed. A song that after 500 years will have passed from the lips of those who made it live to the printed memory of its prior existence in the scholarly journals of tomorrow.
Ooh.